contra 2, Miracle puede, perdón, 89C56, el tratamiento platónico de la biología en el FEDOM. Mariana Gardela es licenciada en Filosofía por la Universidad de Buenos Aires, posee una beca del Consejo Nacional de Investigaciones Científicas y Técnicas, es candidata a doctora en Filosofía por la misma institución, ha publicado un libro sobre los filósofos megáricos y una cantidad de trabajos excelentes, doy fe, acerca de temas vinculados a la filosofía megárica y a Platón, capítulos, artículos. Además se desempeña como docente en la carrera de filosofía en la Universidad Nacional de San Martín, en las áreas de filosofía antigua y griega.
Bueno, gracias, muchas gracias por la presentación, gracias a todos y a todas. El título de mi trabajo, Contra 2 ni Heracles puede, FEDON 89C56, el tratamiento platónico de la antilogía en el FEDON. Voy a comenzar a leer y he preparado algunas diapositivas para que puedan seguir la exposición. Una vez que Sócrates expone los argumentos sobre la inmortalidad del alma en el FEDON, Simias y Cebes presentan objeciones que cuestionan que ésta pueda existir separada del cuerpo luego de la muerte. Estas objeciones confunden a Nataraxai, a quienes están presentes en la prisión, y lo sumergen en un estado de duda e incredulidad. Me refiero al pasaje 88C17. Como expresa Epécrates, interrumpiendo el relato de Fedón, cito: ¿en qué argumento podemos entonces confiar todavía si, a pesar de ser tan fuertemente persuasivo el argumento que formuló Sócrates, ahora se ha precipitado de nuevo en el descrédito? Fin de cita. Antes de responder a las objeciones de Simias y Cebes, en un breve pero significativo interludio, Sócrates advierte sobre los peligros de la misología. Me refiero al pasaje 88C1-91C5. Esta es caracterizada como uno de los efectos generados por el uso de la antilogía, que es la técnica de presentar argumentos opuestos sobre un mismo tema de investigación. En este trabajo me propongo analizar las críticas de Platón a la antilogía con el objetivo de determinar cuál es su sentido y cuál es la relación que estas guardan con los problemas tratados en el diálogo. Intentaré demostrar que la antilogía es presentada en Fedón como una práctica argumentativa con objetivos herísticos que no permite conocer la verdad. Las críticas dirigidas a este procedimiento justifican el desarrollo de un nuevo método de investigación, a saber, el método hipotético, que supera las limitaciones del procedimiento herístico al restaurar la confianza en el logos como vía de acceso al conocimiento de lo inteligible. Comienzo con el primer apartado de mi trabajo, misología, antilogía y herística. En Fedón, la misología es comparada con la misantropía, pues ambas tienen una causa común: la falta de conocimiento experto o atechnía. Quien carece de techne cree ingenuamente que todas las personas son buenas y que todos los argumentos son verdaderos. Esta ilusión se rompe cuando se descubre que la mayoría de las personas se ubica en un término medio entre la bondad y la maldad, mientras que son pocas las que pueden considerarse completamente buenas o malas, o cuando se advierte que algunos argumentos son verdaderos pero otros falsos. El error de juicio provocado por la falta de conocimiento técnico genera una gran decepción. Sin embargo, en lugar de reconocer la propia ignorancia y asumir la responsabilidad del error, se termina por odiar esas cosas sobre las cuales se presumía saber. Los misántropos aborrecen a las personas, creyendo que todas son viles y desleales. Los misólogos, los argumentos. Sobre esto habló Paulo Lima en una sesión en la que yo estuve presente el martes, así que no voy a decir mucho más. Como señala Hackford, la atecnía es producida por el uso de la antilogía. Ahora bien, ¿qué es la antilogía? Según la clásica definición de Kerfer, it consists in opposing one logos to another logos, or in discovering or drawing attention to the presence of such an opposition in an argument or in a thing or state of affairs. Teniendo en cuenta esta caracterización general, en el marco de un debate es posible: 1. Que un interlocutor sostenga la tesis A y su rival no A. Este modo de exponer argumentos es característico de los procesos judiciales, las instancias de deliberación política y los agones dramáticos, como se ve, por ejemplo, en el enfrentamiento entre el discurso más fuerte y el más débil en Las nubes de Aristófanes. 2. Que un interlocutor enuncie al mismo tiempo, de cierta forma, la tesis A y no A, al constatar que ciertos hechos o fenómenos poseen propiedades contrarias. Esto es, por ejemplo, lo que habría señalado Zenón de Lea al mostrar, por medio de la técnica de la antilogía, que las mismas cosas son similares y al mismo tiempo disímiles, unas y a la vez múltiples, y que se encuentran en reposo y al mismo tiempo en movimiento, como se describe en Fedro 261d. Un punto de vista similar habría expresado Protágoras de Abdera, para quien, como ya ustedes saben, sobre cualquier cosa existen dos discursos opuestos uno a otro. Este fenómeno se observa en los primeros capítulos del tratado anónimo de Isoi Logoi, donde el autor prueba efectivamente dos tesis opuestas. La tesis relativista, según la cual la definición de valores como bueno, malo, noble, vergonzoso, injusto, injusto, depende de las personas que en situaciones particulares emiten un juicio basado en su propia percepción. Se prueba al mismo tiempo en dicho tratado, en dichos capítulos, la tesis no relativista, según la cual los valores y propiedades que se adjudican a las cosas son constantes e independientes de quien juzga. En Fedón se presentan dos críticas a la antilogía. La primera, de tipo ontológica, indica que ésta se fundamenta en la tesis metafísica, según la cual todo está en constante fluctuación y cambio, tesis que Platón suele atribuir a Heráclito de Éfeso. En efecto, dado que ningún argumento es seguro ni firme, se supone que las cosas sobre las cuales versan esos argumentos tampoco lo son. Esta descripción se ajusta al ámbito sensible, pero no al inteligible, cuyo conocimiento queda entonces vedado para quienes utilizan este procedimiento. La segunda crítica, de tipo epistemológica, señala que el objetivo principal de la antilogía es contradecir al interlocutor de turno para obtener la victoria en la discusión. Me refiero al pasaje, a las líneas 91a-23. Quienes emplean este método no se preocupan por discutir cómo son realmente las cosas, sino por imponer sus propias creencias y persuadir a quienes los escuchan con el fin de ganar el debate. Aunque esta última característica acerca la antilogía a la erística, se insiste usualmente en diferenciarlas, como hacen por ejemplo Kerfer, Dixot y Rowe. Mientras la antilogía es un método argumentativo que consiste en oponer un discurso a otro, la erística representa simplemente la intención de conseguir la victoria en la conversación, haciendo uso de cualquier razonamiento y sin preocuparse por la verdad o falsedad de los enunciados defendidos. Aunque Platón ha sido o se ha mostrado siempre crítico de la erística, su actitud hacia la antilogía es un poco diferente. En efecto, en la última sección del Fedro, reconoce que esta puede ser una técnica de investigación válida siempre y cuando se utilice con base en el conocimiento que aporta el método dialéctico de unión y división. Pues solo gracias al conocimiento de las diferencias reales que existen entre las cosas es posible presentar discursos opuestos sobre ellas. Y encuentran en la diapositiva los pasajes donde se habla de este tema. Ahora bien, la perspectiva de Fedón es levemente diferente a la de Fedro, pues allí solo se contempla la utilización de la antilogía con fines erísticos. Podemos discutir luego por qué esta diferencia existe. Ahora bien, ¿quiénes son los que utilizan la antilogía con estos fines? Tanto Dixot como Rowe y también Hackford han señalado que la crítica a la antilogía podría estar dirigida a Protágoras, no solo porque Protágoras defendió la existencia de argumentos opuestos, sino porque, como también ocurre en el Teteto, el relativismo de Protágoras se combina con la tesis heraclítea, tal como se observa en Fedón 90c-2-6. Sin embargo, aunque existen algunas razones para pensar que la crítica podría estar también dirigida, para pensar que la crítica platónica podría estar también dirigida a los filósofos del círculo megárico y muy particularmente a Euclides de Mégara, quien se encontraba en la prisión acompañando a Sócrates antes de morir. En efecto, algunos aspectos de la descripción de la antilogía de Fedón se reiteran en Eutidemo, diálogo donde Platón presenta una crítica profunda a la helística megárica, como ha demostrado Dorión en otras sesiones de este simposio. En primer lugar, en Fedón 89-5-10, Sócrates compara la tarea de responder a Simias y Cebes con el combate que Heracles mantuvo con la hidra de Lerna y el cangrejo, para vencer a los cuales pidió ayuda a su sobrino Iolao. La misma comparación se emplea en Eutidemo 297-B9-D2 para caracterizar el comportamiento agresivo de los hermanos sofistas, Eutidemo y Dionisodoro, al cual Sócrates no puede hacer frente solo. En segundo lugar, algunos de los razonamientos utilizados por los hermanos herísticos en Eutidemo poseen una estructura antilógica similar a la que se describe en Fedón 90bc, pues presentan explicaciones opuestas sobre un mismo fenómeno sin establecer cuál de ellas sería la verdadera. Esta característica se observa, por ejemplo, en las paradojas del conocimiento de Eutidemo 275d3, 277c7, paradojas que sostienen al mismo tiempo que aprenden los que saben y los que ignoran, o que se aprende lo que se sabe y que se aprende lo que se ignora. En las refutaciones sofísticas, Aristóteles denuncia que este razonamiento explota la homonimia del verbo aprender, manzanein en griego, que puede significar tanto comprender cuando ya se tiene un conocimiento previo, por eso aprendería solo lo que ya saben, como aprender en el sentido de adquirir un conocimiento completamente nuevo, que es un conocimiento que no se tiene, por eso solo podrían aprender los ignorantes. Este argumento pone en evidencia las ambigüedades de los conceptos de enseñanza y aprendizaje, cuya utilización genera contradicciones y equívocos. Múltiples argumentos megáricos persiguen el mismo objetivo: poner en evidencia las ambigüedades del lenguaje por medio de la construcción de paradojas que operan con base en esas mismas ambigüedades, a fin de mostrar que el logos es una herramienta precaria y falible que nos sirve para acceder al conocimiento de la realidad, punto que ha tratado también Claudia Márcico en un artículo publicado en la revista Arcade. En tercer lugar, en Fedón 90d6-7, Platón señala que una de las consecuencias del uso de la antilogía es quedar privado de la verdad y del conocimiento de lo que es. Esto se debe a que quienes ponen en práctica este método o este procedimiento utilizan las proposiciones para persuadir o refutar sin importar cuál sea su valor de verdad. Es decir, utilizan el logos con independencia de la realidad, socavando así la relación que justifica la verdad o la falsedad, como ha observado Monique Dixot en su comentario al Fedón. Un punto de vista similar sostienen los hermanos sofistas de Eutidemo, quienes declaran que su intención es, cito, refutar lo que siempre se dice, ya sea igualmente falso o verdadero. Es el pasaje 272a7b1. De acuerdo con esta precisión, la herística no aspira a conocer lo que es a través de la postulación de enunciados verdaderos, sino por el contrario a refutar cualquier tipo de proposición con el fin de ganar el debate. Voy a leer ahora el último apartado del trabajo, Antilogía y método hipotético. Bien, lo que deberíamos pensar entonces es cuál es el valor de las críticas a la antilogía que se presentan en el interludio del Fedón. En primer lugar, en el contexto inmediato del diálogo, estas críticas sirven para censurar el comportamiento de Simias y Cebes. Luego de aceptar que el alma es inmortal, ellos proponen nuevas objeciones que cuestionan que el alma pueda existir separada del cuerpo luego de la muerte. De modo que, a la manera de los antilogicoi, sostienen que el alma es y no es inmortal. Aunque las objeciones son valiosas y obligan a Sócrates a presentar argumentos que fortalecen su propia teoría, no dejaría de aprovechar Sócrates la oportunidad para advertir sobre los peligros de argumentar solo con la intención de contradecir. En segundo lugar, estas críticas ponen en evidencia la necesidad de desarrollar un método de investigación que permita alcanzar el conocimiento de las formas. Este no es otro que el método hipotético, que, como ya he dicho, supera ciertos defectos y limitaciones de la antilogía, Yo voy a mencionar solo algunas características de este método sin desarrollarlas en profundidad. Bien, por una parte, el uso de la antilogía, el uso de la antilogía con fines erísticos, engendra odio hacia el logos, como se dice en 90B9C2. El método hipotético, en cambio, pretende restaurar la confianza en el logos al restablecer el vínculo que éste mantiene con la realidad. Por este motivo, Sócrates prescribe refugiarse en los enunciados para poder examinar a través de ellos la verdad de las cosas. Me refiero al pasaje 99E46 que ha analizado, por ejemplo, el profesor Ferber esta mañana. Lejos de ser una imagen deficiente de la realidad, el logos se presenta como una vía segura para acceder al conocimiento de lo inteligible, que de otro modo sería inaccesible para los mortales. Por otra parte, la antilogía no se preocupa por distinguir los enunciados falsos de los enunciados verdaderos. La consecuencia de esto es que los argumentos verdaderos suelen ser desechados por quedar asociados a otros que no lo son. Esto se dice en Fedón 90C8D3. Para revertir este problema, el método hipotético establece un criterio para diferenciar las proposiciones verdaderas de las falsas. Como se dice en el Fedón, tras elegir la hipótesis que se considera más fuerte, por ejemplo, que existen ideas, se juzga como verdadero todo lo que concuerda, synphonein, y como falso todo lo que no concuerda, diaphonein, con esa hipótesis. Este método propone además un procedimiento para el tratamiento de hipótesis que evita incurrir en el vicio de discutir solo por el afán de hacerlo. En efecto, si alguien pidiera razones para justificar la hipótesis de partida, Sócrates prescribe que antes de responder, sería preciso examinar si las consecuencias de la hipótesis enunciada en primer lugar concuerdan o no entre sí, para postular luego una nueva hipótesis de orden superior que permita explicar la primera. De este modo se evita proceder como lo hacen quienes se dedican a contradecir. Estos suelen obstinarse en discutir la hipótesis inicial presentando un argumento contrario a esta hipótesis sin tomar en cuenta las conclusiones que de ella se extraen. Como parece haber hecho Euclides de Mégara, según el testimonio de Diógenes Laercio, cito, Euclides se oponía a las demostraciones no en las premisas sino en la conclusión. Estoy citando Diógenes Laercio, libro 2, parágrafo 107. Los que se dedican a la contradicción parecen no poseer un procedimiento de indagación sistemático y por tanto discuten al mismo tiempo tanto la hipótesis como las consecuencias de la hipótesis, mezclando y confundiendo niveles de análisis sin poder obtener ningún tipo de conocimiento sobre el asunto tratado. De lo dicho hasta aquí, se desprende que las críticas a la antilogía presentadas en el interludio de Fedón no solo ponen en evidencia las falencias de aquellas prácticas argumentativas que destruyen la confianza en el logos, sino que allanan el camino para proponer un nuevo método de investigación que, superando estas mismas dificultades, utilice el logos como medio para acceder al conocimiento de la realidad. Y esto es
todo. You have 10 minutes for questions. Sí,
a ver, mañana quisiera, en primer lugar, felicitarte, muy bien. Y no me acabó por quedar muy claro cómo conectas tú aquí la posibilidad de que el método hipotético me dé un acceso a la realidad. Y sobre todo, tal, aunque hace la correlación con el Eutidemo,
sí.
Y si tú me estás planteando hipótesis, tú dices muy claramente, bueno, yo comparo hipótesis que me conducen a las formas. Pero ¿dónde está esa conexión entre el planteamiento de hipótesis y el conocimiento de la realidad?
Bien, cuando hablo de realidad me refiero a la forma, ¿no? Por supuesto. Y es una discusión que mantuvimos a lo largo de todas estas jornadas si el uso de hipótesis permite acceder directamente a lo inteligible o no, o si en cambio se trata de un acceso mediado que no terminaría de aportar ese conocimiento completo de la forma. En mi parte, y esto es a modo de convicción, creo que sí, efectivamente, por medio de hipótesis, si vamos mucho más allá del punto suficiente del que se habla en el diálogo, podríamos llegar al conocimiento de lo inteligible. Pero creo que esa sería otra discusión, ¿no?
Sí, pero ¿no quedaría Platón así como, tal y como se le suele calificar vulgarmente, como un idealista, en el sentido de que, bueno, tú conectas, pues tú tienes tus hipótesis, y a lo que te dan acceso, y a lo que se está denominando realidad de lo inteligible, y entonces, ¿dónde quiero decir? Como diciendo, ¿dónde está parado Platón? Esa es mi preocupación.
¿Te referís a que son hipótesis que no permitirían, por ejemplo, conocer lo sensible?
O exacto, sí, como que a qué se está refiriendo en exclusiva una realidad inteligible, a que si con esto lo decimos, con el acceso puede ser el método hipotético.
Claro. Creo que lo más importante acá es descubrir o develar cuál es la vía de acceso al conocimiento de lo inteligible, no tanto cuál es la vía de acceso al conocimiento sensible, que es despreciado y además sería en todo caso la percepción. Sí, lo que me parece importante es que el conocimiento es a través del lenguaje. Digo, no se tiene ningún tipo de visión mística o inmediata de la forma, sino que más bien a través del debate y en este caso a través básicamente de la postulación de hipótesis que permitan en algún momento llegar a un principio al hipotético, eso permitiría conocer la forma.
Gracias.
¿No? Alonso,
Andrés. Es una pregunta muy corta, muy sencilla. Si efectivamente usted dice más bien que Platón hace más crítica de las antologías, si eso es cierto, no se puede decir que el escritor produce el mismo una antología.
Bueno, yo escuché su trabajo el martes y usted dijo eso a una pregunta que le habían hecho y yo no podría estar más de acuerdo. Sí, efectivamente, cuando Platón critica la antilogía propone
el mismo, o sea que no es contra dos ideas que se puede, sino ni contra Protágoras nadie puede.
Es cierto, es cierto.
Ni siquiera Platón.
Sí, es cierto.
¿Puedes hablar en inglés?
Yes, of course.
I may have not understood fully because my Spanish is not really good. If you characterize antilogia as either one person saying both A and not A, or one person saying A and not saying not A, so far I think that characterization is compatible with a good way of using this apparent contradiction and a bad way. So, of course, heuristic is a bad way, but having these apparent contradictions is not by itself a bad thing. It depends on various other things, what reasons you give, why you're doing this. So I wanted to ask you, what for you differentiates a good way of using antilegging, presenting a contradiction, from a bad way?
Okay, well, I will try to answer in English. That's why I mentioned the passages of the Phaedrus, where Plato explains what is the good way to use antilogy. And to do this, you have to have knowledge of the differences and similitudes between the entities of the world. So when you have that knowledge provided by the dialectical method, then you will use antilogy in the good way. When you use antilogy just to contradict your interlocutor, well, that's the bad way.
Please. Porque tiene mucho que ver con esto. Por eso me gustó.
Sí,
lo abierto todo de la mano. Justamente en esa misma dirección, que nosotros hemos ya hablado, creo que en el Fedón y en el Fedro hay una crítica y al mismo tiempo una recuperación de la antilogía en un sentido positivo, pero de distinta manera, porque en el Fedón, con el método hipotético, el llegar a una contradicción es lo que me permitiría revisar la hipótesis inicial y proponer otra. Entonces, sería en función de la búsqueda de la verdad en ese sentido. En cambio, en el método dialéctico del Fedro, que es de Unión y División, la antilogía pasa a integrar, o sea, justamente estos dos discursos opuestos de, sobre Eros que aparecen al principio, que parecen oponerse, lo que muestra el método dialéctico es que en realidad son dos aspectos de una realidad en donde tengo que diferenciar lo que tienen en común y lo que tienen de diferente. Entonces, es como una mirada donde la dialéctica sería como una superación de la antilogía en función de esclarecer la verdad. Pero en los dos casos, la antilogía, después de criticar el uso que se hacía corrientemente, Platón la integra a un nuevo método, reintegra. Es algo muy común en Platón, que más que rechazar totalmente, critica y lo integra en algo nuevo.
Claro.
No sé si...
Totalmente, te agradezco por la observación. Y lo que más me interesa es la conexión que has hecho entre la antilogía y el método hipotético Eder-Fedón, que son en realidad dos procedimientos que yo he intentado distinguir,
sí.
Pero se podría ver alguna conexión
claro.
Por medio de la cual la antilogía podría usarse como primera instancia para revisar hipótesis, ¿no?
Claro.
No lo había marcado. Gracias.
A ver, última pregunta.
Gracias. Felicito, querida.
Gracias.
Es una pregunta muy concreta que tiene una pequeña coda, a saber, si esos logos contrapuestos los considerarías contrarios o contradictorios. ¿Por qué te digo esto? Retomando un poco el comentario del principio, porque da la impresión de que si Platón propone como una especie de solución superadora, creo en el Fedón, a esta situación, el método hipotético, ocurre como bien dijiste. La hipótesis inicial de la que se parte es una hipótesis que uno juzga, a lo largo del crino, ¿no? Juzga, y después se afirma no lo que concuerda o lo que discorda, sino lo que a mí me parece que concuerde, de manera tal que siempre parece permanecer un elemento no tan deductivo en sentido estricto. Por eso me pregunto si en realidad ese método hipotético no podría partir, en términos del conflicto antilógico, tanto de la hipótesis A como de la hipótesis no A, que si más que contradictorias son contrarias, sería una hipótesis B en realidad. ¿Se entiende a dónde va la pregunta?
Sí.
Gracias.
Creo que en el caso de la antilogía mucho depende, digo, para decir esta cuestión de si se trata de argumentos contrarios o contradictorios, mucho depende de los ejemplos que tomemos para el análisis. Y en algunos casos, sobre todo en los argumentos herísticos que yo cité, los ejemplos son de tesis contradictorias, no de tesis contrarias, pero sí es muy cierto que si optamos por partir de tesis contrarias, sucedería lo que vos muy bien decís.
Pero en el propio Fedón parece ser más contrario.
Exacto,
¿no?
Exacto.
Okay.
Sí,
gracias.
Sí, sí, sí. Gracias.
Thank you. The private degree is a master research of philosophy at the University of Edinburgh with distinction. Her main research interest is ancient epistemology and its conversation with the contemporary epistemology. Her thesis project is a comprehensive analysis of the unity as Plato knew. She is to speak about immortality of soul, soul and form of soul, Plato, Philo, 100b, 107a.
Thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you so much for coming. I have to admit that this book in progress is under revision, so I would appreciate if you are happy to follow on my presentation today. I'm going to talk about immortality of soul and form of soul in Phaedo 100b and 107a. To be more specific, from 102a to 107a, it offers a prominent and a difficult argument on immortality of soul, for which Socrates indicates that it depends on the theory of form 100b 7 to 9. At that point, Socrates actually casts out a sequence of the specific forms such as beauty alone by itself, a goodness, a largeness, which seems to be his prior concern at first sight, and then implies that there are a certain range of forms apart from them. until 107a, after endorsing theories and arguments, Socrates said to Cebes with impressive confidence that it can be concluded that soul is immortal and imperishable, and our souls really will exist in Hades. From the beginning to the end, it seems that the final argument on immortality of soul has specified a pivotal and hypothesis and a conclusion consisting in several layers of meanings. What my paper focuses on is the disputative problem of whether there should be a hypothesis of form of soul according to the text that may contribute to overcoming some long-lasting difficulties in the final argument on immortality of soul. Regarding the form of soul, I find Brian Fring's claim of form of soul with capital F as a result of his investigation into Phaedo is a problematic yet valuable and interesting, especially the framework for discussions. Problematic because when he turns to explore the details of the arguments and tries to argue for form of soul, the failure of the final argument, he may not have realized that sometimes he processes a pivotal and strong claim without clarifying why it is so, if any textual evidences exist. For instance, why is it warranted to say that it's all too easy to imagine that soul exists or be destroyed in this final argument? My motivation is that by extending or upgrading his arguments for interpreting Socrates' final argument, such as reflecting on the Brinner principles and to construing a scheme of the various examples of maybe not able to unify them, but to find their relations. So that many potential suspicions towards his claim could be avoided. And I can also at least temporarily think that saving the hope of form of soul, which may lead to some new discoveries or interesting discussions in connection to the theory of soul in Republic, Phaedrus, or Timaeus in the future. For example, I was often think about it speculative, if there's the what is the position of form of soul exists in the hierarchy of forms according to Plato's theory, or how it relates to the unity of soul, if I can argue reasonably for the unity of soul among the dialogues. Accordingly, my research has been organized in a special way, that is, the primary task would be attempting to resolve some key problems concerning the form of soul according to Prince's discussions. The comments and textual analysis of the relation between immortality of souls and the form of soul in Phaedo do emerge occasionally. More than a century ago, Arthur Hinds and Jane Bunnett took contrary stances on this topic. Arthur Hinds commented that idea of soul is a metaphysical monstrosity, but it's not a sufficient reason to avoid an argument of Phaedo. Bunnett apparently disagreed with her. And said there's no word of form of soul in the text, so no such assumption is required. About half a century ago, Hackforth discovered that there's a change of status of soul from soul as form to soul as possessor of form in specific passages in the course of arguments. Based on his suggestion, Keith argued that Plato is likely to treat the soul to be immanent from, or at least to be one. He further pointed out that the fallacy of the argument for immortal soul is a consequence of treating soul as if it were of one by Plato. So against the views from Hackforth and Keith, J. Schuller attempted to refute the proposal that soul is construed and forming disputative argument for immortal soul. For recent, most recent discussion, Prince has contributed to a comprehensive paper to argue for the implicit function of form of soul in the immortality argument. He argued firstly that a form of soul must be one of the forms Socrates would be prepared to recognize according to the range of forms he suggested. What's more, he insists that the final argument for immortality of soul turns out considerably weaker on reading it if he denies the form of soul. And it would be much weaker to the extent that alternative stronger justifications, on the contrary, would be required for taking up argument in this way. Prince's paper also makes response to some points regarding the form of soul made by Menedic Sword. Notice that there's no argument in so many words that souls can never be participating in the form of soul. The fact that there are not so many direct or positive discussions on form of soul, according to my own knowledge in Phaedo, may largely stem from the lack of the specific terms in the dialogue. and it will like to cause a doubt about the meaning of speculation, speculative arguments. However, a lack of the, this kind of evidence does not rule out possibility in theory. In fact, resolving textual problems such as the soul and the relation between soul and form and 80B, will increase the probability. When it comes to the final argument, Prince mainly argues for the probability of form of soul, pointing out two implicit problems with our reading of the form of soul, and three positive reasons for accepting it. And I think both these parts, all these parts are, have some problems without clarification. Interestingly, the textual evidence of the two problems without reading this form of soul are frequently also used by many scholars who are against the form of soul for defining their own stances as well. It suffered its earlier characterization of forms and its relation to forms from 78b to 80b. So, for example, it's perfectly obvious, Socrates, that the soul resembles the divine and the body resembles the mortal, or the following, that soul is most similar to that which is divine, immortal, intelligible, uniform, and capable of being indiscreditable. For Prince, if one would argue for permanent and necessary relation between soul and form of life as a significant phase of arguing for immortal soul, in one argument, one problem is the earlier view of the relation between forms and soul, assuming souls lacking stability in their own right. It's because the early characterization of the forms as stable and unchanging is tending to the properties to soul in virtue of whatever degree of resemblance individual souls manage to achieve. Even if Socrates intend to claim at the ATD that souls are as stable in their own right as the forms, there remain progressive problems. Although all the characters have agreed in ATB that souls are much more like forms than sensible objects, the assumptions turn out to be insufficient to prove the immortality of soul. This failure indicates that it is unconvincing to recycle the earlier assumption to complete the final argument. Similarly, Prince uses the same reason that the earlier assumption from the failed argument of immortality would not be helpful to validate the final argument. When he supplements that the alternative reading is failed, that the form of soul should be treated as implicit support for Socrates' claim that individual souls have an essential relation to the form of life. I do not agree with Prince's method to say earlier assumption from seemingly failed argument cannot be of any use for the final argument. Nor do I agree with the view that the earlier assumption is used to deny any possibility of the form of soul in this final argument, because it's an understatement of to only say similar or resemblance. What probably can be related to Prince's arguments is that I do not see how the previous claim would truly be a threat to discover the assumptions in use in the final argument. A final attempt to argue for immortal soul. Firstly, the previous claim is in the context of comparing soul and body to other characters referring to forms, or it is more accurate to hold that Prince's way of arguing for the two problems can be sustained on the condition of being further clarified. The implication of similarity as on the statement of identity for the earlier argument of immortality results in the failure of that argument, hence it is not visible to function as a limit of the final arguments. Schuller also holds this view. Correspondent to the existing discussions on the final argument, I also divide arguments into two phases, phase A 102A11 to 105E10, and phase B 105E11 to 107A1. I insist that only comprehension of the arguments for both A and B can count as reaching the conclusion of the final argument on immortality. And again, Prince's arguments for failing the phase B are obscure. One, the structure of the argument requires a form of death, 105D9. Two, since the argument is built upon pairs of opposite forms, and since Plato permitted him forms of life and death, it's hard to object to the form of soul for this reason. In order to relieve the worry of the consequence of assuming the form of soul, I construct a framework of three related and controversial issues for special consideration, which are not unfamiliar for people who are interested in fine argument. First is Bruner's principles. The second is screen with examples, fire, snow, fever, number, or with the relation with so. And the last point is arguments of the indescribability and immortality. So firstly, the goal of regarding phase A is clear. The defender has to establish that, one, so long as the soul is a soul, it's necessary, necessarily participate in the form of soul. Two, and anytime, anything that participates in the form of soul also participates in the form of life. I discovered there's a reminding passage and 101d7 tonight that implies that you need to come to something sufficient, not only applicable to the Bruner's principles, but also invoke consideration of assumption of a certain form of like soul. Then, so for the first step, so long as soul is a soul, it's necessary to participate in the form of soul. Prince also uses the eponymous principle, like for those things that have necessary properties besides eponymous property of being what they are, these further opportunity properties should be explained by relation among forms, not by relations directly between individuals and forms. According to him, this flawed argument failed to prove the necessity of soul participating in this form of soul. Although it is an argument of some plausibility, without cautious examination. Moreover, it's worth ascription to Plato. But why may we agree with such suggestions? So I also want to discuss the relation of examples like application of the principle of Bruner's principles, or say to speculate the relations among forms. So back to the one first. There's a first argument with regard to safe atia all the way. Like first kind of safe atia explaining the is explaining the more sophisticated one. That is why we are talking about Bruner's now. So the passage are 104d1-7 and 105d3-7. And hopefully I don't have to read through this passage, but what I have found from this passage is the comparable parts, like from the 104, d1-7, there's a part saying whatever the form of three occupies must not only be three but also be R. And from the 105 part discussing about Fuhei, is that can be translated as whenever so occupies anything, does so always come to it bringing life. It's not just the consequence of a deliberate translation, like this not a perfectly comparable. The whole structure of the two sentences imply that they are not perfectly parallel to each other. However, I do not mean that they are not perfectly parallel in the sense that the relation of three and oddness in no way are comparable to the soul of life, which may leave open the possibility of form of soul. So for the second point, anything that participates in the form of soul also participates in the form of life. Another argument is theory of form and beginning of this part. Even form of life can be affected as a result of denying it. For Prince, form of soul is mediation for souls and the form of life. And for Schuller, Bruner is the intermediate between properties and forms. After all, he would only admit basic forms. What I often find confusing are the relations among examples from the final argument of Phaedo. Fire, snow, or also fire with fear, fever, and numbers. And beginning of the chosen part, form's beauty by itself, good, largeness are mentioned. However, distinguished from the so-called parallel structures of the argument above, listing the certain forms does not bring any relative discussion subsequently, which merely leaves an impression of the distinctions of the form. Moreover, regarding construing the parallel structures, in spite of unclearness, Socrates seemed to prefer to use the beings of the fire, snow, fever, and numbers. All of them are in possession of some advantages over others in different aspects that can help us to understand the parallel structure with those activities. Maybe they are helpful for understanding the form of soul in relation to body to be occupied in different ways. So some may say have been attracted by number and its unique appearance of as the idea of three, controversial or literally because it's just appears once in arguments. Nevertheless, when comparing number and soul, the connection of the process of occupying for the two are less obvious. Considering the key passage on the safe idea and a transfer to another kind of safety and 105b to c, Socrates stresses that don't give as your answer whatever I say in my question, but follow my example. So I have compared two passages of this part. The first is when it comes to be present in anything's body, makes the thing hot, he would answer fire. The second is when it comes to be present in anybody, makes the body ill. I will not say that it is illness, but say but that it is fever. Here, I intentionally leave out the case of number, which is kind of irrelevant to my discussion now. The cases of fire and fever to be followed at the same time are quite interesting. Maybe when we take into account the history of Greek medicine. After all, if we fail to consider the Greek context, it is transferable to say that third, when it comes to be present in anybody, makes the body ill. I will not say that it's illness, but that it is fire. Or fourth, when it comes to be present in anybody, makes the thing hot, he would answer fever. These attempts unnecessarily bring more confusions and problems, or it may shed light on a certain distinction between greener and the coarse in Socrates' sense that is in accordance with the principle of greenness. Otherwise, I would be very confused when I reflect on specific unfortunate case, for example, of fire deaths and fever deaths, and list the example of fire and fever seems to be more advantageous than the mathematical number formally in this sense, to understand the case of soul and body, or soul and death. Admittedly, when we turn attention to the soul instead of soul and body, the properties of numbers make it more competitive. So I'm short of time. So I will say, I'll add that Prince's discussion on indestructibility and the ending part is too hasty. So I would make it my third concern. They are intent to demonstrate that the logic flow of the final argument is appealing to a form of soul, which should be more convincing than Prince's ultimate method by merely an animation that justified that trying to justify the form of soul as the only choice left for Socrates' proof of indestructibility. So I will definitely, in my paper, to move on to address the tricky questions of the indestructibility. As I say, the phase B may failed, even though the form of soul could make it in a better form. And I'm convinced that the discussion of Brunner's principles and clarification of the example in terms of soul are prerequisites, during which, for Prince's interpretation, some problems left that could have been prevented us from observing a broader picture of theory of soul and the beautiful dialogues are reviewed and resolved. So thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much for nice analysis. Well, of course, it's really difficult to have a single coherent view of the final argument. But still, I'm a bit wondering why we need a form of soul. Because, well, it's already a very complicated picture. What is the merit to put the form? Because form and immanent form. So, well, that clear distinction in the final, in the first stage, you know, the Simias and Teres speak and Lysias spoke, that use that clear form. But gradually, the example changed into not that initial stage, but some different kind of analysis, it seems to me. So could you just tell me why the formal form is necessary in the final argument?
probably what I'm in the same state with the prince is that this form, probably I didn't manage to make it, but the form of soul could make this the failure of arguments, final arguments of immortality of soul, less free from the attacking. And as I also mentioned, the form of soul, as speculator, I think if I would be able to connect it to the like other dialogues as the structure of the cosmos, a view of the Timaeus, I have this ambition to justify the kind of the unity of soul, despite of the tripartite structures in certain dialogues, and I would favor the form of soul in Phaedo like as a simple soul.
Yeah, of course, it's good to have a relation to the other dialogue, but inside the argument itself, I think it's so, I need to agree about.
I have a similar problem. I'm not sure, but I think I can put it differently. If you think that we should have a form of soul, then it seems to me that by parallel reason, we should have a form of fire, we should have a form of snow, we should have a form of three, and that is, I think, very important.
I would say I don't really take that strong claim of like I think the form of soul the presupposition of the form of soul is different for to presuppose the form of fire or form of.
If you think of the structure of the argument, of course I agree that fire and soul are very different things, but if you think of the structure of the argument, why, you have an underlying something, why something hot, so that's a quality. You can say, on the simple theory, because it participates in hotness, that's a form, or you can say, because it has in it fire, and fire participates in hotness. So it's entirely parallel argument. So why is something alive? We can either say because it participates in the form of life, or you can say because it has soul in it, which participates in the form of life. So I think these two arguments seem to me to be entirely parallel. That's why I'm saying that according to the argument, if you want to have a form of soul, you should have a form of fire.
As I was trying to say, is these two arguments are not perfectly parallel, because it's but I have to admit there's a differential of the English translation, like the way to understand it, and the original casting Greek like seems to be more parallel to us.
Thank you for your paper. I was just thinking, you remember Socrates himself doesn't seem driven to think that there's a form going with every general term in language. I mean, for example, Parmenides, very good example, he doesn't think there's a form of mud or dirt. The trivial things he said. But they are, for, they are general terms in language. You know, one might tend to think from reading, say, the 10th book of the Republic, the opening lines, where he says, you know, there are forms for those general terms that we tend to be talking about in our discussions, meaning things I take like beauty and truth and goodness and so on. He says that's true. But even there, he never goes so far as to say there's a form for every general term. And then, of course, in the Parmenides, the young Socrates says, well, there clearly can't be forms for trivial things like mud and so on. So clearly he's not driven by any sort of metaphysical argument to say, well, soul is a general term in language, so there must be a form of soul. So that would be one thing I want to ask you about. What's your reaction to that? And hypothetically, let's just imagine that there is a form of soul. Where does it sit in the architecture of the form of the world? Is it distinct from the form of life, or is it a synonym for the form of life, or does it relate to the form of life in some sort of genus-species way? Do you have a picture of the architecture of the form world, and where this would ever be if Socrates really thought there was a form of something?
For the first question, I didn't make it here, but I would say like the discussion in the Phaedra, like the range of forms are not ruled out. Past it could be put in either way. It does not strongly afford there's a form of the range of forms can contain the form of soul, but it's not in also in not in a negative way to rule out there's a possibility. So my first motivation, like, why not even try to consider this quite interesting. Like, so subsequent to this interest, I would like to explore, as I also mentioned in the presentation, like the position, speculative the position of soul in the hierarchy, I would say, the serial form. But I should admit that I don't have absolutely clear picture or answer to that. Yeah, but I would say the form of the relation between form of soul and form of life can be enlightened by this part's discussion on principle, Brinner's principle, exemplified by forms of like what is
the form of the computer and the form of the software. Is that something?
I don't know about that form. Just the form of. I'm trying to think about the form of soul and the form of life, like how they are related to each other, which is quite important in the late that part of my discussions.
Okay, so just relax for a moment and give it some thought.
He has experience in teaching philosophy at the University of State of Rio de Janeiro. He think about life rather than arguments. He's saying what the second said.
Thank you, Graciela. First of all, I have to say three fast things. First, I will be immensely grateful to Czeslaw and Nix for having done the English version of my paper. Second, I want to dedicate my presentation to Yasmin Yuksh, who swims like a mermaid. And three, in view of time limits, I will not read all the blue parts of my text. So let's go. Life rather than arguments. Resetting Socrates' second saying. Oh, please turn off the light, please. Quote, I was afraid, you know? That was what he was. I was afraid. I couldn't make out the bank of the Brazilian River San Francisco on the other side. Far, far off. How long would it take to get there? Fear and shame. The brutal, treacherous water. The rivers full of menace, deceitful ways, and whispers of desolation. My fingers clutch the side of the canoe. End of quotation. Three moments of Phaedo. Quote, well then, don't you surely think that there are things to add to what has been said? Because many of those things still remain suspect, and the story points open to attack. If someone wants to sufficiently examine them, if any of these things leave you in a horror, do not hesitate. Now is the time to speak and explain. Simeon is speaking. It seems to me, and maybe to you too, Socrates, that a safe knowledge is something either impossible or totally difficult to acquire, and that without submitting what was said about these things to absolutely all kinds of examination and giving up before investigating them fully, someone who gives up is a man with a flabby spirit, because about these things it's necessary one of the following options: either to learn in some way, or to find out by himself, or, if these options are not possible, taking among the human lobby one that is at least better and less liable to be refuted. It's necessary to embark oneself on it, as taking the risk of crossing the life navigating a raft. If it's not possible, what is the safest and riskless option? To be carried through life in the sturdier watercraft, some divine logos. In fact, Socrates, to me, the things that the word said did not seem to have been completely and satisfactorily said. Maybe, my friend, it's true the way they seemed as sufficient to you. Scene 2. I would be happy if there was something to be somehow learned about this cause, and was deprived of this. And I neither discover it all by myself, nor discover what it is from someone else. Do you want me to make an exhibition of the second saying that I realized in search for the causes in this? I certainly do. It seemed to me necessary, when seeking refuge in the logo, to look for the brings truth in them. Perhaps the somehow does not look like what I imagine, because not even I completely agree with investigating what certain of the beings in images in the logo, more than investigating it in concrete things. However, my impulse is this: by hypothesizing on each occasion the logos that I decided as being the strongest, the things that seem to me to be in consonance with it, I consider to be true, and those who do not, I consider not to be true, either in terms of the cause or in terms of other things. Scene 3. After the demonstration of the immortality of the soul has been accomplished, I at least, Socrates, have no doubt about these arguments. But let myself, after all the things that the word said, but in spite of it, due to the magnitude of the objects of this logo, and not shocking a high consideration about the human weakness, in my inner being, I still feel obliged to have doubts about the things that the word said. You speak correctly, not only about these things, Simeus, but also in relation to those formed hypotheses. Although they seem reliable in your view, it's necessary to examine them fully in the most reliable manner. The second saying, expression, an outline of the scholar's dispute. In Berger's, Gallup's, and Fisher's views, the expression deuteros plus has two possible meanings in Greek. It may mean, when someone is sailing, to use oars when wind stops, or we'll call it meaning A. Or it may mean a second safer method to do something. I will call it meaning B. Berger and Fisher see evidence of meaning A in fragment 241 key of the comic poet Menander, and evidence of meaning B in Scholar's comments about Phaedo. In his turn, Gallup states that the first of these meanings is well attested and suggests a second best method to accomplish something. Nevertheless, he does not affirm anything this way about meaning B. About the specific use of that expression to characterize the hypothesis method in Phaedo, Berger, Murphy, and Dussault adopt the meaning B. Berger, following Murphy, states that Socratic's second saying proves to be safer, and its apparent inferiority must be put into question in light of the danger and unreliability of the first way. Dussault seems to follow the same trend when he claims that the expression second saying envoie un autre parcours, indirect, plus long, mais plus sûr, and ce qui évite les errements de la navigation précédente. Robin and Robson hold that the proper meaning of such expression is second best, pis-aller, But they point out an ironic use of eating Fido, as well as Burnett. And the same position have Goodrich, Hackford, Shipton, Bostock, and Fisher, who consider that the hypothesis method contains an inherent mark of insecurity, therefore is really a second best way. I will call it meaning C. Daughter follows a compatible direction that states that the method reaches not definitive but provisional answers. As regards to the first two above mentioned meanings, meaning A and meaning B, I will compel to say that commentators that present them as being two alternatives seem to have lost the point of the Deuteronomy's Plus expression. The expression is really a proverb, a metaphorical expression diffused as a proverb. As it happens with every metaphor, it presents an image to which a meaning was attached. Therefore, the nautical picture of the oars is the very metaphor of the expression, which does not exclude the existence of an ulterior and more general meaning for the proverb. In my view, the problematic point of the presentation of meaning A and meaning B in a two alternative scheme is its suggestion that these two things are self-exclusionary. Explanation of the second expression, image, meaning, and utilization. As pointed out that by the scholars, the description of the image or metaphor is a fragment of Menander's lost common Thasileo. The second saying is doubtlessly the saying that if it helps someone, the winds fail to sail using oars. The explanation of the meaning is among other places in the Schola Greca Platonica. Second saying proverb, as regards those who do something in a safe way, in parallel with this, those who fail to reach the security of the first sailing prepare themselves for the second one. After first to deal with something in an unhappy way, those who treat it in a second tentative say to do a second sailing. An easy example of use of this proverbial expression. Besides Phaedo, the other applications of this by Plato, as well as the Aristotle's ones, are undoubtedly very debatable points. On the one hand, as I have said before, because many accusations were made by scholars stating that Platonic characters were being ironic when they mentioned that proverb. On the other hand, because we modern readers do not have what contemporary readers of Athenian and Socratic philosophers had, a complete knowledge of and familiarity with the meaning of this proverb. And maybe this is the main reason of the actual quarrel about this topic. Counting on the familiarity of their readers, these two ancient authors used the second sale expression, not only without explaining it. Indeed, they used it to elucidate the other affirmations. Remembered by Shipton, a much more illuminating example of the use of the second sale expression can be found in Book 8 of Polybius' History. The quotation is long, but it's worthwhile. The context deals with the relationship between the states and war. While, therefore, we must censure those who unconsciously put themselves in the path of the enemy, we should not blame those who take all possible precautions. For it is absolutely impeccable to place trust in no one, and we cannot find fault with anyone for action by the dictates of reason, after receiving adequate pledges, such pledges being oaths, wives, and children, held as hostages, and above all, the past life of the person in question. The safest course of all, therefore, is to seek for such pledges, as we render it impossible for the man in whom we trust to break his word. But, as this can rarely be obtained, the second best course is to take reasonable precautions. Giving all the explanations about the context of this historic citation, the meaning of the Deuteronomy's Plus then appears in a crystal-clear mode and in full consonance with the above-quoted explanation by the scholars about meaning Philebus and Phaedo. The best will be a path with absolute guarantee, that is, one in which any failure will be impossible. However, considering that such absolute certainty is extremely unusual, almost impossible to attain, one must be satisfied with a not so good but available option, namely the second sailing way. The metaphorical proverbial expression means, in that sense, the meaning see. A path that, though lacking the desired total guarantee, is the path that can be followed. This is my point. The second same proverb in the Greek language of Plato's time was analogous to Brazilian proverbs, such as, if you don't have a dog, hunt with your cat. Or, to a person who is dying by drowning, even an alligator can serve as a lifeboat. Hence, in spite of the allegation of some great scholars mentioned above, in the Phaedo, the hypothesis method is a really unsafe method of searching knowledge, which, far from being the ideal, best, and more desirable way, is the only one available for this accomplishment at the moment. This notion, as I have tried to demonstrate, may be found all the presented reference, the scholar to Philebus and to Phaedo, the Polybius passage, as well as the Phaedo's passage referred to. In this sense, the use that Socrates made of the proverb in Phaedo not only takes again the navigation metaphor, but is in fully in accord with the fragile and insecure raft image used by Cineas. As Trabatonis said today, an insecure and fragile raft. This is the metaphor adopted in Phaedo, first by Cineas and later proverbially reinforced by Socrates, that represents maybe the only possible search for knowledge available for us, human beings, to accomplish the course of life. Abstract of the picture outlined in the three quoted moments of Phaedo. We may now extract from the dialogue the following affirmations about certain matters. To safely acquire knowledge is either impossible or extremely difficult to attain, and it's necessary to submit to a refutation scrutiny in absolutely all the proper manners the argument about said matters, and persist until such examination is completed. Conditions for using the hypothesis method that was qualified as a second sailing, that is, an alternative way with uncertain success. If it's not possible to attain a safer, more devoid of risks, and more firm knowledge. If it's not possible to learn with someone else. If it's not possible to find out about oneself. Then the hypothesis method, a second sailing, remains as only possible way to take from the human logos what's best and more difficult to refute, and assume the risk of going through life on it. Characteristics of this method. Investigating what is being searched about beings by means of logos and images. Hypothesize on each occasion the logos that one decides to be the strongest, and take it as a criterion of truthfulness. What is consonant with it, what arises out of it, what considers to be true, what's not true. But the magnitude of these matters and the human weakness demand that one should always mistrust the logos and hypothesis, at least until they are submitted to an in-depth examination. Final considerations. Sailing without guarantees. Quote. The brutal, treacherous water. The river is full of menaces, deceitful ways, and whispers of desolation. My fingers clutch the sides of the canal. You must be brave, he, Jadorin, said. Could he see that it was on the verge of tears? It hurt me to answer. I can't swim. The boy smiled pleasantly. Neither can I. Calm. At the start of my paper, I said that its layout and limits would certainly leave many questions open to discussion and consideration, and that the objective of this communication was to present in Phaedo the characteristics and conditions of the hypothesis method, as well as to explain the meaning of the expression used to qualify it, second sailing. So, now that objective has been fulfilled, we can see that my advice has a lot of consonance with the characteristics of the very method described in Fido. Because, as it shines resplendently in all the references, as well as in the proverb, this method has as its main features the insecurity, the uncertainty, and the fact that a definitive truth for the problems cannot be found. However, the consequence of acknowledging this evidence extracted from the text cannot be investigated here. They go beyond the time and the dimensions we are subjected to. What could Plato want to mean with this lack, this incompletion, this fragility about arguing about some matters? Did the father of the academy intend to point to some secret teaching absent from his written works? Or did he want rather to indicate the weakness of the non-divine human condition? Better yet, did he want to point to the fact that, in respect of such weakness, our condition is the obligation to always go after the unremitted search in spite of everything? If so, maybe could he Platonic character start also saying, giving him a fictitious Brazilian way, when you are entering a forest without a dog, a potter, you must hunt with the cat that you have. This is the duty, the task, the need of effort of the daughter as love of Porus and Penia, the philosophy. That is, my final suggestion is, in his deathbed, more than try to convince friends about the truth or complete certainty of this or that argument, the real persuasion desired by Socrates may be the idea that the kind of life worthy to be lived is the life he lived, to which a philosophical life, a life as a continuous quest for knowledge, uninterrupted research and examination. If becoming a perfect sophos can be something possible only for a god, to love Sophia and to exert themselves to walk in its direction is certainly possible for human beings, in spite of insecurity and no assurance that it would be attained. At least, a life of endeavor seems better than a life of laziness or total hopelessness, as we were told elsewhere. In this sense, the silence of Socrates in the dialogues, the incompleteness of those discussions when facing certain matters could be, above all, the invitation of man to the continuous thinking, to the soundless calling of his friends inside the drama, and of readers outside the drama to the indefatigable questioning, to the cross of life, as long and how philosophizing. Quote, well then, don't you surely think that there are things to add to what has been said? Literally, that the said things need to be said right away without reluctancy. He drank the hemlock to the last drop. He let down on his back. He had become hard and cold in almost all the lower belly when he uncovered his face and said these words, the last he ever spoke. Crito, we owe a cock to Asclepius. Don't forget to pay this debt. I will. But if don't he still have some other thing to say? This question remains unanswered. Crito closed his mouth and his eyes. Exactly like Guimarães Rosa's character Jadorim, crossing the torrential and brutal Brazilian River San Francisco in a so fragile boat, Socrates was calm, calm. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for Rodolfo for controlling the computer.
Thank you very much for interesting talk. Well, in your footnote, sorry, I read in advance. Well, I in a sense agree that you distinguish the method as in general and hypothesis as a content. But still, I think it makes difference between which particular hypothesis we use. So hypothetical method itself is unreliable. Well, that's make difference in which kind of thesis, proposition we can put as a hypothesis.
So the I do not fully agree with that the method itself is just unsafe. I mean, it depends on what kind of hypothesis we put. That's, you know, that is the issue. So could you just tell me why you think that the method itself in general is discussed here, not the content of the hypothesis. Just to explain something more.
Thank you very much, Dr. If you can accept the symmetry connection between the structure of alternatives that Simmons drew and the fact that Socrates called your own method of a second best way, how I can try to demonstrate. And I think that we can accept that he thinks that the hypothesis is have a intimate characteristic of provisionality, of the possibility of again, of possibility of being abandoned in some time, as after the about 102, he said that if you see that hypothesis is not working very well, we can abandon this and choose another hypothesis and begin again. And well, and after, I agree with you that the last quarter of me, the 107, I agree with you that it is a comment from Simmons and from Socrates about the specific hypothesis used in the dialogues. I agree with you, but if you can accept what he Socrates said before this example of the use of the method, I think you can accept that some provisionality is some characteristic out of the method.
I think my question is in a way similar. So you want to emphasize the idea that it's inherently risky, and right after he mentions the second sibling, he immediately talks about how he avoids risk. You know, he doesn't want his eyes to be hurt by looking into an eclipse, and so he does this thing precisely in order to not experience risk. And then when he's describing the actual hypothesis that he uses at 100D to 100E, he emphasizes the safety in what he's doing. There's all this talk of safety. So in fact, for I think it is the safest to give this reply both to myself and to another, and I believe that if I cling to this, I could never fall. But it is safe to reply both to myself and to anyone else. So it seems like those two things give us some constraint on the interpretation. It can't be all about risk, given that what he immediately says is that he avoided risk by not looking into the sun, and that he came up with something that was extraordinarily safe. Now, it's not clear to me that something that's second best is always riskier. So I don't know that you get to move from the fact that something's a second best to its being inherently risky. And so then given all of the emphasis on safety in what comes next, I just wonder if that suggests that we shouldn't think that what we're getting from the second sailing, it doesn't have to do with risk. So that's the concern.
Thank you, David, for the question. Undoubtedly, in regards of the search of the physiology and the try to learn with Anaxagoras, it is to try to expand the reality from material things. It's undoubtedly the method of hypothesis is safer, is very, very best of this. What I try to, it's okay for me, I completely with you. What I try to emphasize is that it's good, but it's not the ideal method. It's not the ideal way to reach truth. I think it's that in this way that Socrates used the proverbial Greek proverb of the second best. It's undoubtedly is safer is in regards of the to look for beings. This as the image of the eclipses, but I think he stated well, but it's not what it's not the best, the best. I think is it.
So thank you for your paper. I'm very glad with your words and your relationship with the Brazilian literature. And I think I ask a comment on your comment about how do you think your paper is in connection with the Trabatoni talk in the morning? So, because you remember Guimarães Rosa, and I think it's a good thing because Guimarães Rosa said in a philosophical thing that the human is a special place. The human being is not a god, but he is almost a god, or he is more than the animals. So I think it's a good thing. So we have a responsibility, and also we have the laws to be. It's a provisional. It's not a dogma, but I think we must to use our law going. So it's only a comment for you about that.
Okay, thank you, Delmar, for your intervention. Fortunately, Franco is not here. Yes, I think if our conclusions is almost the same conclusions, but there is something in the middle specifically about the idea of first saving that I'm not in agree. I agree not with him. And it's a very long discussion, but it's because the proverbial I have tried to show has an image and a meaning. If you take the image, okay, you try to look for a first saving in the dialogue. But if you look into the meaning, it looks like that there's not a first saving dialogue.
Well, that was precisely my question. What do you understand the first saving? If it is to grow like the ghost, which is impossible for us, and to grasp the immediate grasp of the ideas as Ferber suggested today, or if you have another way to understand what would be the first saving would be.
Are we recording it?
Sorry?
Yes. About it. Okay.
You think that there is no first saving at all, according to what you have
yes, said? Yes, I think that in Fido's text, in the meaning, not that of the text, internal text of the dialogue, but the meaning of the proverb. That's the scholar said, who failed to reach the security of the first saving prepared themselves for the second one. So, failed to reach the security. I think that failed to reach the security not necessarily means that you have tried that first thing. No. And
you don't say that you have tried, but how do you understand what the first thing would be, even if we cannot,
Well, I think that Mr. Ferber has interpret the eclipse passages as a direct vision, but as David put here, as the eclipse passage is not direct, a direct vision to ideas, a direct vision to sensible things. So I think he, I not agree with him about this.
Okay, I just to support what you're suggesting, I mean, you can ask the question, why is it risky to proceed from the hypotheses? And it seems to me like one of the real risks is, what if the hypotheses are wrong? That is, we're just laying them down and moving from them, but they're not known that they definitely exist and why they exist. So it seems like there's the element of security in moving according to this method. But there is, it's, I agree here that there's that residue of riskiness in the method, insofar as you don't actually know that they exist, but you're just putting them down, did they not, as a premise, and then proceeding from them. So, to affirm.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Eli. Yes, it's not a question, it's not a suggestion. Okay. I think Carolina maybe has
Carolina.
A...
So, I just wondered how you would explain the proverb itself. Because I think that you agree that what it means is that when you don't have the, when you cannot sail with the winds, you use the rudder. How is it less safe? I don't know where the point of risk comes in, unless that you're, I'm afraid the reference you're using to introduce risk are later references and not 5th century, 4th century references. And it really doesn't make much sense to me that the difference between the winds and the force is a difference of risk. It seems much better is a problem of effort.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's a very good question. Thank you for it's a passion. It's a some of my gift that I have to.
But if you take up the risk.
Yes. Yes. But that's the point, Karen. When you have a proverb, you have not taken literally the image of the proverb, but what it means in that time. So as Mr. Fred and Mr. Trabatol said, there is one work that I didn't know of an Italian professor that showed that in all the existed passages of Asian literature, in 79 totally, the proverb has sad pejorative means, have a bad, it's a second best definitive. So we cannot take the image. I know, I agree with you. By the image, well, using ours is safer than...
Safety is not an issue.
That's
safety,
what?
It's not an issue. It's not an issue.
That's right.
It's not an issue.
The risk is
always. It's effort that's an issue. It's harder to do.
The explication by the scholar and the use of polybius that I showed is of 200th century. It's absolute about safety. It's not about exporter. It's about safety.
Kind of, it is a later thing, but it's kind of, you have to read, because the point is how you make people work for you. You can make it directly or can make it indirectly. And the political problem that is there can involve effort, not only risk.
Fourth speaker is not coming, so we finish. Thank you very much.